it's kind of the coming together of a passion for old cars, which I have been afflicted with, and a passion for audio. Yes, I've been a professional audio recording engineer for these 40 years, but I've always enjoyed and been driven in that work by a love for good audio, good sound, good music, bring those together. So the joining of the old car passion with the audio passion resulted in some craziness here, which I can share with you. Let's start with a little bit about the vehicle, literally, for the sound system. Just over a year ago, I'm on bringatrailer.com, and this strange little Volvo came up on the auction site. It clicked a number of boxes. It was a little mini wagon. It had a manual transmission. It was a nice color that my granddaughter and I both liked. And the pictures on the internet auction under the palm trees looked glorious. The website, again, bringatrailer.com. They're not kidding. I had an Audi S4 Avant with a 6-speed. I miss it dearly. And this was as close as I could come, afford, whatever, to clicking a number of those boxes. So I went up literally to my highest bid for this vehicle, partly because I remember them back in 73 when they were built. They were exactly twice the price of the Pinto. Could not contemplate the Volvo at twice the price. So I got the Pinto wagon. But this thing had always been in the back of my mind. So this comes up, clicking all of these boxes, bid it up to my maximum, said I'm done, and the clock keeps counting down and said, you're the high bidder. Holy crap. So I literally yelled to my wife, I said, pack your bags, bring a trailer, we just want a car. And, you know, there was this strange moment, a little gnashing of teeth, but that's what you see. This is one of the first pictures I took of it on the way home, on the trailer, and the weather, the clouds, I think were foreboding of a lot of what was to come. It's like, I should have known, based upon that, we were in for a ride. When I got down there to Florida, where the car was, it would hardly start, the overdrive didn't work, the gas gauge didn't work, 6 of the lights didn't work. I mean, it's Lucas Electrics. That's what it's interesting about the car. Tiny bit of history on the vehicle. Back in the 50s, Volvo Corporate was looking at the affluence of the post-war economy and thinking, gee, maybe these families coming back that are earning all this money would like a sporty car, a second car, a fun car. So their corporate got together and, well, they had a consultant to Volvo who was pushing this idea, oh, look at the cool Italian sports cars of the 50s. That's kind of what this was patterned after. And there's an interesting footnote that said that consultant who talked Volvo into building some kind of a sporty GT car went to a couple of body design firms, and he found Frawa in Italy, who was able to take on a project. And this consultant to Volvo said, I'll give you a commission for a new car if you hire my son. He designs boats. Frawa did it. They signed up Peter Peterson's son. And the son was Peter, but anyway, signed him up. This is kind of the first thing he penned as a vehicle. And the early sketches reveal a whole lot on this P1800 series, it's called, beginning in a coupe style, that became the P1800 in 1970. Ran the coupe version up until 71. Interest was lagging after a 10-year run. So Volvo said, what do we do to extend the interest or life of the car? Let's take it, design in a little mini wagon. They're called shooting brakes from the old British usage for these mini wagons. The interesting thing is the original designer, Peterson, didn't like the ES. He didn't like them making a wagon out of it, but he was out of the picture and done, and they made the wagon. So these things have in fact become a lot more rare, partly because they only built 8,000 of them over a two-year model run, 72 and 73. That's all. So that is one of 8,000 over there. Last Saturday, footnote, we had a Volvo Club event. We had three of those at the Ipsy Warehouse in Ypsilanti, which is pretty rare assemblage. So they're out there. Yes, we are a close-knit group, some ways in fun, some ways in pain, keeping them going. But yeah, I decided down in Florida, okay, most of the problems were stuff I could probably deal with. The bones were good, paint was decent, body was a Southern car, very good in that respect. So I decided, okay, bit the bullet, dragged it on home, and over the past year, especially the past winter, hundreds of hours, thousands of dollars to get it to a reasonable point. So here it is sitting here in this service bay, and I've got the windshield wipers fixed, I've got the heater controls fixed, I've got some of the funky D-jet bleeding edge fuel injection fixed, and I'm making progress on the car. And then I'm thinking, the sound system in it was crappy. There was a dual in-dash cassette player, had an aux in, but that's all you could say for it. A pair of janky 5x7s in the luggage compartment in the back, and it sounded hideous. But I said, gee, there's already holes back there. I'm not going to be cutting any new holes, but I could enlarge a 5x7 hole to an 8-inch round hole. So I started looking around the shop, and this is where it got out of control. I found a box. Yeah, let's see. Let's take, okay, here's some beauty shots of the car. All right. This was last summer here. So, okay, realize all that's got to be done over the winter. This here is a heater valve that goes way up under the dash, because you couldn't turn the heater off, and on the test drive in Florida, we were cooking because the AC didn't work. The heater wouldn't shut off, and there was not even a thermostat in it, so it still warmed up just fine in Florida, but not when you get it home to Michigan. So we started working on it, and I started thinking, well, gee, if I enlarge the holes in the back, I found this box with a pair of speakers. I don't even know what they are. I think they're from Mattisound. We've got a bunch of these. My buddy and I built up some of these 8-inch bandpass boxes with Mattisound drivers.
No numbers? No numbers whatsoever?
No idea. And the funny thing is, the box they came in had a return address sticker from Jackson Speaker Reconing. So they were just back from Reconing, the two of them sitting in this box. I pulled them out, tested them out. They both worked. They didn't rattle. Okay, got a pair of 8-inch, call them subs, don't call them, I don't care, that they would potentially fit in the back. Yeah, if I enlarge the hole, so I started in with that. So then I said, okay, you pull those panels apart, as you can see, the trim panels, and what's behind there? Well, there's some structure to work with. There's a gas line you see on stage left over here. Got to figure that out. I made up these wooden panels out of some leftover IKEA cabinet doors with the proper cutout, and then used this structure here, drilled some holes around here, as you see, to sort of drill that structure into place. So that's the wood mounted in behind there, nicely screwed in place, which really served to stiffen up the structure, which is kind of what you need, with the shape of the body that's a rounded shape, kind of like an E-type Jag. Up in the front as well as the back, there's a lot of cubic footage between the interior body or trim panels and the exterior of the car. So you put a little leftover insulation from a spare piece of insulation up there and pack it full of that, and you figured I was kind of on my way. What else did I find sitting on the shelf? Some awesome Optimus three-way enclosed speakers. They kind of fit the curve of the back. You see, I got this sense of order that rules my life. If I find something like this that seems to kind of fit and it's been sitting on the shelf, why did I save that all these years? I got to use that. Oh, this would be perfect. So these things I mounted up in here and actually got, pretty well mounted. I got it the wiring fed over to where I could run an umbilical up front. You can see I had a spacer here to bring it out a little bit because of the gas line, the gas filler pipe in there. So I had to bring it out just that inch and a half. You're not going to move the filler pipe and so on. So that's the compromise on the driver's side of the car. But I looked up on the shelf up there, and I found some ADS 2002 internally bi-amplified speaker amplifiers. Those things, I remember back when I used to work for Douglas Sound selling hi-fi back in the 70s, were awesome, filling a room from this little tiny box. I think, I don't know if they were 40 watt or 60 watt or what they were, like maybe 30 in the tweeter, 30 in the woof, 20 in the tweeter, something like that, doesn't matter. Little 4-inch woofer. So certainly not extended low end, but clean and linear from 80, 90, 100 on up. We had many speaker demos where we would have sometimes big boxes. In the house, I've got a pair of Cost Model 1 electrostats that are, you know, they're huge, 19 square feet of base. And we'd park the little ADS on top of those things. We'd bring people into the room, and, oh, listen to those speakers. Aren't they awesome? We'd crank them up. Which do you think you're listening to? Oh, it's got to be the big boxes. No, it's the little tiny ADS. They were amazing at what they would do. So, okay, I found a pair of them. I had these in a van a long time ago. I actually had two pair. I had a left-right pair for the driver and a left-right pair for the passenger, and thought that was the hot setup. But so I pulled them off the shelf. The wire that comes out, obviously a left and right audio, which is foil shielded. And then you got a white wire and you got a green wire for DC. How many think the green is positive? How many think the white is positive? You see? Okay, you win, and I won. I'm scratching my head saying, okay, am I going to potentially fry these if they're not protected, or am I going to win? And I went with white as positive, hooked it up over there on the bench. I got a little crackle and no smoke, and hooked the audio up just with some leads to the head unit there on the shelf, and I got some audio out. I said, cool, I'm on a roll. I got polarity figured out for the DC. Tried the second one, no tweeter. Okay, you wiggle the trim pot for the tweeter, nothing. The one worked perfectly. So you pull the tweeter out. Sorry, but they are right over here. It's kind of like a standard Peerless tweeter, except when you look at the model number, it's not. Because you go on eBay and they've got loads of these tweeters. In fact, for these, also ADS, L400s, but they're bigger. These are smaller. And so you try and find one with that model number on there. And I finally got sort of lucky in that I found somebody selling a pair, $80. I figured, well, if this is the key to getting this whole thing working, I haven't spent a cent so far. One of them was all smashed in.
For 80 bucks?
For 80 bucks, yes. Yeah. So buy it now. Got them in. I got them on order. They're coming in shipping. The next day, a pair of brand new ones comes up on eBay from Korea for $20. Shucks. Okay. Well, I'm committed. So I had the old one out, got the new one, soldered it up, put it in, and it's dead. Oh, crap. So then I started, okay, what else could it be? So I started fiddling with the tweeter level pot on the back. Crackle, crackle, crackle. Psh, she came on. Yes, just a dirty pot. I'm on a roll again. Okay. So that's kind of been the up and the down with getting this thing going. So now, okay, I've got my working ADS 2002 speaker amplifiers. What do I need next? Well, I had a bunch of car audio sitting there in the shop system. And one of them was this ADS power plate. I think it was a power plate 80. And I figured, okay, I'll use that for a pair of eights for low end. cross over nicely from the ADS for the rear channels. A year ago, I bought a pair of Boston Acoustics two ways, little 6-inch, little molybdenum tweeter, and I figured, gee, that would go perfectly up front. I could just set those on top of the dash. I wouldn't have to cut anything, kind of invisible, because think about it. Here I am with a rare antique car. How much cutting do I want to do? That's a no-no in the old car community. And I wrestled with that many nights. So far that, in fact, I went to try to find a head unit that mimics the early stuff. Sure enough, Custom Auto Sound makes one that some resellers are Volvo branding, pair of knobs with USB interface, so on and so forth. Okay, got one of those on order for the head unit. And then I'm thinking, wait a minute, I need variable crossover frequencies. I may need some EQ. I've got a Custom Auto Sound secret audio in the Thunderbird. Pretty lame. The USB will not talk to an iPhone. If you hit USB, it'll charge the phone, but it won't take data. It will not take streaming audio. Waste of time. And then if you use the AUX in, the mini, I'm plugging it into my iPhone here in picture, you have to select the AUX in, and it quits charging the iPhone. So it's like, duh, that ain't going to work. So I honestly just canceled the eBay order with the seller and decided, okay, if I'm going to pull this off and I'm doing this much work with this much reasonably high-end stuff, I got to get a modern head unit that'll talk to modern equipment, modern phones, whatever. So, yes, I cut the dash and put in a modern Pioneer. I know. I've been flamed online for it. Some of the guys said, oh, yeah. I haven't really put it out there big time because I'm not willing to take the flaming. I know that would happen because the first thing anybody complains about with an old car, oh, that damn previous owner cut the dash. What am I going to do to make it right again? My argument is, number one, that's a number three driver. It's not a number one restored or restorable car. Number two, I'm going to enjoy it. Number three, I'm hoping that the awesome audio system may about equalize the drop in value maybe for cutting the dash. You can fix the dash if you need to. You can get a plastic overlay. That is repairable. The panels already need replacing in the back. If you look at it, you'll see they're worn out. They're shot. It needs new carpeting. I'm not going there in this lifetime with that car anyway. So that's kind of the thought process. So, okay, I decide what I've got to do to get that in. Now, back to the ADS. Footnote, those things were sold with a knock. I found out after looking for the tweeters. They were sold with a Nakamichi 550 portable cassette deck as a package. So if you think about the awesome little remote recorder playback monitor system with a 12-volt wall wart, you could power your NOC 550, which I also owned. All those cassettes up there are theater and cathedral organs of England, Wales, and France, recorded with a pair of AKG 5, never mind. And a NOC 550 going all over Europe. And so I've got Pierre Couchereau improvising at Notre Dame on there with that system. Yes, I played it after the fire. That was a pretty cool system with a 12-volt power supply and that NOC 550 and the pair of ADS and so on. But I think that's why they weren't particularly well filtered for automotive. They were kind of adapted for automotive because they had a 12-volt amplifier. So how do we fit this in the car? Well, this is the second place for the ADS power plate because the first place I figured out the cables wouldn't reach to the head unit. So I had to unbolt it from there and bolt it back over in the passenger side of the car. But that's where that went in. ADS don't have any relay for remote turn on. So here I go back to the parts bin, find an old period Radio Shack project box, little old terminal strip. I got a box of 12-volt relays. I got a fuse holder. So here it is. You see the pair of RCAs for the input on the left. They are wired to the left and right audio. And there's your white wire connected from the relay for positive. Your green wire. And here was, it's not a stroke of genius, but it solved the problem. I pulled out the terminal screws, bored out the terminal strip, put in a pair of self-tappers, force it through with an impact, and suddenly it mounts the box and grounds it. So that's a ground strip right there, just right through the terminal strip, sitting right there. Those of you that are anal retentive about this, that second from the left terminal strip has no wires on it. It wasn't used. We can't have that in a well-ordered system, so stay tuned. This is where it ended up, just behind the right rear tire in the Volvo. It's down, all down under the floor. The wire to the right side woofer was maybe 18 inches long. Left side was probably barely 4 feet long, so it's well connected to the amp. The cabling just barely worked to get it up front. You see I got it all loomed over here on the right to get it up and over the wheel hump, down under the door sill and up to the front. They had, I think, 22 gauge zip cord going back to the speakers from the previous owner. I used that as a pull wire. There's how it fit pretty nicely down in there with a power amp and so on. Yeah, that's the unbranded, who knows what it is, woofer. It appeared to be 4 ohm, as near as I can tell with an ohmmeter.
There's a number on it.
There's a number on it?
Yeah, 834.
What do you think, Russ?
Something underneath that tape would tell you that's the year that you see there, but the tape before that would probably tell you the EIA code.
Okay, but do I care?
Sonatograph.
It was in stock?
Sonatograph. Could be.
It was recalled recently.
It was in stock, it was cheap, it was free.
Yeah.
So there we go with the ADS 2002 mounted in there.
CTS.
All right.
No.
These ADS, they don't use DIN connectors, they use Jones plugs. What were they thinking?
Right.
You know, they're notorious for, because they're designed to take some current and not, you know, low current stuff. Constantly have to clean them, but WD-40 worked better than contact cleaner in my years of experience with them.
What's a Jones plug?
They came in, I think, a 2-conductor, probably a 4, a 6, a 12 was a big Jones plug, okay? Multi-pins. Crown recorders, use them for the remote controls. You know, you plug this thing in. I got 2 of those, Dale. Following installation, here's the back end of the Volvo. Pair ADS, firing forward, pair subs. Now we move to the front. The right side, passenger side, you've got the umbilical coming up and over, and there's not a lot of extra there. Those RCAs barely, in the end, made it to the location of the head unit. You can see the crossovers here hanging off of the multi-pin connector that plugs in the back of the Pioneer. This hole over here, I don't know if I got a better... This took me 3 hours to cut that hole in the kick panel. Now, the good news is, being an old car, I didn't have to cut the door cards, okay? It's not in the door. It's pretty much buried up there. You really don't see it.
Look acoustically correct.
It's what?
Not acoustically correct.
But wait a minute. It's in line with the tweeters that are up on the dash. So I'll argue that, but not... too long. This is the left side. After spending 3 hours with a die grinder and different things to cut that blessed hole down under there, down under the dash, getting hung up on the evaporator unit for the AC that was sitting down on the floor because I didn't want to disconnect the lines, I said, okay, I'm going to go to Home Depot. They make a 5.5-inch hole saw that'll cut through metal. Right. Just right through. So I got my hole saw, and I figured, well, gee, if I actually just leave that trim panel in place, cut through the whole thing, everything will be aligned perfectly. And then I said, better check and see if there's any wires behind them. There were, right behind where the hole would have been.
Ouch.
So ouch is right. I as you see, laced those around the location of the hole, And then the darn hole saw wouldn't work. It hit and it jumped around and it was so bad because the arbor didn't fit closely into the drill. It didn't work. So that went back to Home Depot, got my $50 back, and went back with a die grinder and another 3 hours to get that one. But at least I could reach it easier because there wasn't an AC evaporator hanging down in front of me. So I cut that in. Again, the rounded panels, plenty of volume in there, and it's all metal, so I put a couple of spacers to space it out for the trim. Got it in place, and kind of works. This one actually has the proper Boston Acoustics grill. The other side does not. It came with an Infinity, who knows why, but I'm not arguing. It was all free.
Blood, sweat, and tears.
You see, this is funny. I didn't even plan that, and I posted this on my feed on Facebook, and a lot of people noticed that and said that is
prophetic,
yeah, pathetic and prophetic. Yes, it's both. When I got the back end done back in this mode here, just to try everything out, you see kind of an identical Pioneer head unit for the shop system. I got a pair of 12-foot RCAs and ran the low end out to the umbilical to test the subsystem and the high end out to go to the ADS and so on. And it was the first time I kind of fired that up. And I had an Eagle CD nearby, threw that on. And modesty aside, it kind of blew me away. I go, dang, this may work. This may work. It was really satisfying. So I said, okay, at least it all works, kind of proof of performance to that point. So carried on cutting the holes and wiring in the head unit. Had to cut that out, as you see. This is when the clock was out for repair. I got a quartz movement in that now. Underneath, and here's the little tweeter. You'll see if you take a look. This is obviously a big picture, but looking in from outside of the car, I'd call it fairly stealth. And all I did was run the little wires down behind and took a dot of hot glue, poop, parked it right there on the dash, so it's removable. I don't think it'll tear up the leather or anything. So that's what we got on the left. Same kind of thing on the right. So you get the thing fired up, and what happens? Alternator whine. A little bit of spark click. Okay, here's an example of the guy who can't throw anything away. I go downstairs and I've got a box of noise filters from back in the day. I had two of these. I got the old transformers if you need to send it through to more Archer Radio Shack awesomeness. You know, I'm that guy. I even got the, if it comes in through the antenna, you can filter it out of your antenna if that's where the noise is coming from. Anyway, I traced it down. It was just the ADS that were noisy. I figured that's good, so I don't have to put this on the whole system. Remember that spare terminal and the terminal strip down there? Yeah.
Number two,
you guys are on it. Yeah, so come off the 12 volt. So I Googled this on the internet because this seemed to be the piece I wanted. It's good for 12 amps and noise suppression. It's got a ground and in and out. Okay, probably a choke of some sort, yeah. And the instructions say run positive to the red, output to your load to the blue, ground the black, or if that doesn't work, unground the black, or if that doesn't work, trade the red and the blue, or if that doesn't work, who knows what, you know? So it's like, whatever. So I hooked it all up as option one. It improved it a little bit, but it was still whining. So I did what they said and just disconnected the ground. She got quiet. I'm going, we win. We're done. To reward myself, I got the Nardi wheel for the thing. Before that was this big plastic Volvo padded safe.
Is it manual steering?
It is manual steering. It is high effort manual steering. So the smaller wheel was a leap of faith. But with Carlstrom's help in steering setup and alignment and telling me how much better it should be, and doing some work on that. We've got it to a point where it's survivable, it's workable, and...
Suicide knob you can put on?
No, no. You got to have your gear set...
Park right, you got to learn to do the right thing so that you don't have to...
That's right, and you got to have it dialed into second gear before you hit the corner and crank it around, and it'll go, but it is high effort. I was amazed at some of the functions the Pioneer has built in. You've got position adjustment. What the heck is that? Exactly. You got this. You know, left front, right front, left right rear, front rear, or none. And I can't tell, well, it seems to do some nice things in terms of setting up. Oh, that sounds good. You click it. Oh, that sounds good. You click it. Oh, that sounds good. But, you know, being a recording engineer, I'm the guy who wants it to sound just like I did it in the control room and faithfully carried through. That seems to be in the maybe no processing. It's even got time alignment function. I haven't messed with that yet. But that's what you get in the modern head unit. And there certainly wouldn't have been any of that in the proper Volvo branded whatever. So I'm calling it a success. We actually did some measurements on it today that other people may share with you if they so desire. And I've also got it set up for actual auditioning with a little old iPod with some pop stuff, the usual Steely Dan and Donald Fagen and Pink Floyd and so on. And another USB drive that some of my jazz and classical recordings done up here or out on location with Flint Symphony and so on. Some orchestral bombast with organ and all of the above if you want some of that stuff. So I'm calling it done, and check it out and see what you think. But thanks for listening. Any questions or...
Yeah, Dave. Did I hear right? You said the original sound system had a multi-cassette deck,
a dual cassette deck.
DUAL. That's a DUAL. It's a brand name.
Oh,
what a brand.
It's just a brand name for a cheap in dash, like dual turntables.
Okay. They sell those at Walmart. They're really inexpensive.
Used to.
I believe it.
Oh, they do.
And you should see the speakers. Had this shiny cone. And they put a 6x9 grill and a 5x7 speaker. I mean, that's how impressive.
For what was in there?
The pair of 5x7s in the back.
With a 6x9 grill.
With a 6x9 grill, yeah. Talk about pretension.
There's some videos on YouTube of guys who go to Walmart, buy the dual system, the dual brand, for like $29 and put it into their Honda and stuff. You can buy an active subwoofer from them too, and it's some ridiculously low price. But for what you get quite a bit for the $29.
Yeah, it was worth it.
How was the overall low end support because of the larger chamber that you have rather than a car?
Low end support?
The cavity itself.
Does it have deep bass?
Does it have... I'll give you a 16-foot organ pedal. Check, I'm serious.
Yes.
Just check it out, see what you think. I'm calling it pretty darn successful. But think about the good news. I've got a fairly rigid structure to work with because of the way I was torquing those wood panels in, because the metal was a little bit bent, the wood was pretty straight, so you force that together, suddenly it gets stiff, okay? Fill it full of, you know, absorbent padding, insulation behind. So you've got a fairly rigid structure and a fairly large cubic volume behind it. So I'm on a roll there. Then you look at the shape of the cavity back there. It's pumping fairly close to the back of the hatchback, which is like a horn. So you open the hatch, yeah, you lose out. You close the hatch, she loads. And I think it works quite well in that regard. We got lucky or whatever, but that's, yeah.
I have an analyzer I brought with me. It'd be fun to just kind of set it up and look.
Bob just did that.
It would do.
That's what we were doing with the 140, and he's got the printout.
Okay.
So happy to share it with you.
Wonderful.
Disclaimer, the bass is hot to hear it over the road noise. I guess that's pretty standard.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But yeah, absolutely. Okay. Because you look at any curve on the Ranchero with a pair of Flowmasters, you've got to crank it way up to even hear it over the VA. But yeah, in the Volvo, it's not that bad. So check it out.
Bob?
Yes.
Would you like to say a few words about what it's like to measure a car with a 40-year-old white 140 analyzer? And a little bit about what you found in David's car.
Certainly.
Oh, you did it with a Sharpie right on top of the LEDs.
Well, actually, there's a picture of me in the 100th Smoot-Hums anniversary book, the 100th meeting, I guess it was, about 20 years ago, that showed me under a towel with one of these DLC design graph paper charts that are made to fit over the LED array there, so I could see those dim LEDs that were lit and connect the dots to form a curve that you saw in that handout that I passed around. Well, when we first started this measurement this afternoon, there was a basically at the low end a flat response through the last 40 hertz LED. So it was flat down to 40. That's good. There was a peak at 125, which David dialed down on the head unit. And then there was also a peak at about 8K, that's about an octave wide, that he dialed down. So taking what we measured initially, the way it was set up, and then remeasuring it with the moving microphone averaging, it actually looks very good and sounded quite reasonable. And even after EQing 1,000 cars at Chrysler or taking 1,000 measurements, you can tell even outside the car if it's going to sound good or not, at least bass to treble balance-wise. And when it's all done, the chart is here. I can pass this around also. The bottom one is what is set right now. And I'd say it's pretty nice. The other thing is, this is a 1/3 octave analyzer. Today, we really prefer 1/12th octave. Basically, each keynote on a piano, the whole width of the spectrum. You can dial it in really well with that kind of resolution. But in 1970, mid-70s, this was it. And it sounds just fine. Any questions?
What's the scale on this?
Oh, there is a scale that is marked 2 dB per division.
Oh, okay. Well, it's sort of crudely done. But this two means 2 dB.
each line is...
This is the late 70s top state of the art.
Yes.
No, but was this put in by hand or...
I wrote that in by hand because there's a range switch there. There's either a 10 dB range or a 20 dB range.
These divisions then are 2 dB.
Yeah, 2 dB per division, yes.
Okay.
And really you have to have that kind of range to get the room curve or the reference curve that a good response measurement should match. Oh, yeah. Is it crude? Yes, but it's 1970. You know, 1970.
I'm not commenting on the quality. I just really want to know what those, were they 2 dB apart, those lines?
Yes, they are.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Not judging the quality of the instrument on the basis of that.
Thank you very much.
And definitely go out and listen to the car.
There's Smith's gauges. This and the clock had to go back to New Mexico for rebuilding. Yeah. Found a shop and they put a quartz movement in the clock. So I think it's actually on. Look at that. But you want the pop stuff or the classical stuff?
Pop stuff for me.
All right. Anyway, there's your track list. Here, let me start it out with this.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.